Hi guys, Luke here from Luke Tech Reviews, and I've been using the ROG Li for the last few weeks and I feel like I'm ready to now share my thoughts on a device and whether I think it's worth you picking up now that we're in 2024. Just a disclaimer before we do jump in, this review won't be full of benchmarks and specs, so if you're looking for that, there's plenty of channels out there, but it's just not my style. What I will give you is an everyday user perspective for someone who's a dad and barely has time to game, and someone has come from a console background, so growing up with the PlayStation series, and in general just loves trying out new tech. So for a bit of background, the ROG Li is actually my first console since my PSP back in 2005, which at the time I absolutely loved. I thought it was amazing that I could play games like FIFA back then on a device that was in my hand. Then I thought it was just absolutely incredible. But since then, obviously I've got older, I got married, I got kids, I got a job, and gaming has kind of taken a back step. I even recently sold my PS4 because it was kind of gathered in dust and not being used. Not because I didn't want to, I just didn't have time to have the telly when everyone in the family will be using it for various reasons. However, recently with Christmas just gone, my daughter got a Nintendo Switch for Christmas, which she absolutely loves. And to be honest, when she was asleep, I gave it a go one day on my own and I was hooked. I absolutely loved it. Now, it's just the LCD Nintendo Switch, and it's this one that you can see here. But being able to play games again in my hand, just on the sofa or in bed, was a bit of a moment where it made me think, I wonder what options are out there other than the Nintendo Switch. Because I had a great time on that, but I was kind of hoping there was something more powerful out there. So I started Googling and I came across the big three, which you always hear about. So the ROG Li, the Steam Deck, and the Lenovo Legion Go. So I ended up ordering the ROG Li, but I did also end up ordering the Steam Deck OLED, which I've got over there. So there will be a review coming up on the Steam Deck OLED, so make sure you hit subscribe so you don't miss out on that one. But let's begin with the ROG Li and let's go through the design. The ROG Li costs £599 here in the UK, about $599 in the US. The device comes in white, which to be honest is probably one of my bugbears. I wish it came in a black color because the white shows up a lot of dust and a lot of dirt. It could get quite frustrating because it's hard to get rid of once it's on the device. You could always stick a skin over the top of it from the likes of Dbrand, so it's not a massive deal. But it's just a small detail that I wish they'd added a black and a white version so we had a bit of a choice. The Li comes with 512 gigs of SSD storage on board, so there should be plenty of storage to get you going downloading games and installing them straight onto the device. The chip inside of the ROG Li is the Z1 Extreme, or Z1 Extreme if you're in America, and it's a pretty powerful chip, so it's enough to play most of the games that we had today, including AAA titles, which is pretty cool when you think about the size of the device and what it's capable of. On the front of the Li, you've got a 1080p 7-inch touchscreen IPS LCD display with a refresh rate of 120Hz and a 16:9 aspect ratio. The screen actually offers VRR, which is a variable refresh rate display, which actually gives you a leg up over the likes of the Lenovo Legion Go and the Steam Deck OLED, because those two devices don't offer it. So that's one trick that the ROG Li has on its side, and I think as a gaming device, Asus made the right decision by adding that in, and I'm quite surprised it was missed out on the likes of the Steam Deck and the Lenovo Legion Go. The display on the ROG Li can go up to 500 nits of brightness, so it's not quite as bright as the Steam Deck OLED, which is 600 nits and then 1000 nits of peak brightness in HDR, but I've never struggled to see anything on the display when gaming around the house, and I think the colours, the quality display and the brightness are all pretty good, and I've got nothing to complain about whatsoever. The fact that it's LCD to me has not made a difference because the display quality is really good and you're not really going to have anything to complain with. The speakers are placed on the front of the device and these speakers are really, really good, and I much prefer these ones to the ones on the Steam Deck OLED. I'm trying not to do a big comparison, but it's hard not to when you've got both devices. But the speakers are really good. They have like virtualized, like Dolby Atmos effect technology. And what it tries to do is throw sounds around your head. And when you're playing this at higher volumes, it really does immerse you in the gaming experience. So when I've been playing Hellblade recently, it's really throwing the sounds and the whispers that are in that game all around my head. So yeah, pretty cool and really immersive. The controls for the Li place just above the speakers. So you've got your D-pad and your joystick on the left-hand side alongside two other buttons, which I'll explain in a minute. And on the right-hand side, you have your other joystick and your A, B, Y, X buttons and another two buttons, which I'll explain in a minute. The back of the device has a Republic of Gamers logo on, alongside two buttons on the back which are customizable to do what you want in certain games. So if you're playing an FPS shooter, you can set them to bring out secondary weapons so you don't have to move your hands around a lot on the device. On the top of the Li is your power button and your fingerprint scanner. So just there you can see a power button has a fingerprint scanner built into it, which is pretty cool. So but you can just put your hand on there and it'll just unlock the device straight away. I never had any issue with the fingerprint scanner. I've seen a few people moan about it online, but to be honest, just the fact we've got one is pretty nice, and it's been pretty reliable. There's the odd time it hasn't worked and I just pop my password in, but 9 times out of 10, absolutely fine. Next to that, you've got the volume rockers, just there up and down. Those are nice and clicky and tactile. Next to that, you've got the USB-C slot and your XGM mobile slot. So the XGM mobile, I'm not going to touch too much on because I haven't used it, and if you want to use it, it's quite expensive, but all it does is unlocks an external GPU, so you've just got a lot more power to play with. If you're docking this and want to use it on like a monitor, you'll be able to benefit from higher graphics when plugging into the XGM mobile. But as I said, I don't know too much about it. That's about the extent of my knowledge, so I'll leave it there. And next to that, you've got the micro SD card and the headphone jack. The RGLI, as far as software, runs Windows 11, which if everyone will tell you on YouTube is quite controversial. My opinion, I'll get to a bit later on in the review, but there's both pros and cons to Windows, same as there is with any software on any device. Now for the ergonomics and how the device feels in the hand. The Ally weighs in at about 608 grams, which is pretty lightweight, and it doesn't really get fatiguing in the hand. It feels nice, there's a good grip to it. But I do think for longer gaming sessions, personally, I think the Steam Deck OLED is a lot more comfortable because on the back, if it picks up on camera, but this bit is quite flat on the Ally, and even though it looks curved on camera, it's not very deep. So the front of it's fine, but I just wish the back was deep, because on the Steam Deck OLED, you can really dig your hands in there and just set yourself still ready for longer gaming sessions. Going back to the buttons that I mentioned earlier, so your A, B, Y, X buttons, those are nice and tactile and have a good response and travel time. The only thing I don't like is the joysticks. I think they feel a bit loose, especially compared to the OLED Steam Deck. They don't have any resistance when I'm putting left to right, especially games like Call of Duty or The Finals, which I've been playing recently, which is pretty cool. I just like a bit more resistance because I just find it a bit too loose for getting my aim correct on the device. And as I mentioned earlier, there are 4 buttons on the front, which are placed here, here, and here. So on the front left of the device, you've got a view button on the top left, and then you've got your settings button underneath it. And what that one will do, that will give you access to your brightness and your volume, any settings that you want to change in-game. And if anything freezes, there's a button there to end tasks, which has been quite useful for the odd time where a game is frozen, I've had to exit quickly. On the right-hand side of the display, you've got your menu buttons. You can press that to pause games and check out the options in the settings within the game. And the other button there is almost like your home button. So that is the armor crate button. So Asus have decided to implement a skin over the top of Windows 11. And that's to try and combat the fact that Windows 11 can be a bit finicky because of the size of this 7-inch touchscreen display. It's quite small. So Armoury Crate is just having all your games. Asus have made Armoury Crate to have all your games in one centralized window. So you can just select them and just get gaming as quick as you can. In there as well are things like your Armoury Crate updates, and it will tell you if you need any updates for your BIOS. And you can also adjust things like the fan speed, the fan curve. I don't tend to do that, to leave it on the default settings, which come with the Ally, which are your 7-watt silent mode, your 15-watt performance mode, your 25-watt turbo mode, and then your 30-watt turbo mode. So those are all the different TPD levels that you get within the settings button on the left of the screen. So while I'm on Windows 11, I'll just summarize my experience on it. So as I said, it's both a pro and a con. And the biggest reason it's a pro is that you can install any game, you can install any games library. So if you've got games pre-existing in libraries like Ubisoft and the Epic Games Store or Xbox Game Pass, you can natively install those straight onto the ROG Ally. You don't have to worry about doing any workarounds or trying to find stuff that's just not available on the device, because every game store is supported, which is pretty cool. Unlike the Steam Deck OLED, which is obviously locked down to just Steam, and although some of the others might be available through tinkering, it's so much easier on the Ally, because in the Armoury Crate options, they actually point you towards the other game stores like Epic, and makes it super easy and simple to download. So I'm not going to sit here and bash Windows 11, but the couple of negatives I did have are that obviously it's not optimized for a screen of this size. 7 inches isn't very big, and if you think about it, every time you use Windows 11, it's going to be with a mouse and a keyboard, and that is just so ingrained in your head. And when it comes down to using it as a touchscreen, it just doesn't feel quite right. So the screen is just small, and trying to hit the little settings buttons just isn't quite where I want it to be. So I think Windows could do with just optimizing the experience for the users of people like the Asus ROG Ally and the Lenovo Legion Go. And then the other one is there are sometimes some crashes and updates which have caused a few issues for me. So the one big one recently was there was an update to Windows which I didn't know it happened overnight, and then when it came to play my Nintendo 3DS emulator using the Citra app, the Citra app just kept closing, and I'd open it and it would close again. And after about 5-10 minutes of trying to figure out what was going on, I googled it and on Reddit, and thankfully someone had posted that during the new Windows update there was an OpenGL app that had been installed as part of it. I had to go into the settings and into the apps and then uninstall the OpenGL app, and as soon as I did, the Citra app worked and I was straight into Nintendo 3DS emulating again. So thank you for that person on Reddit. But there are sometimes quirks like that which are out of your control, and unfortunately when you've got Windows 11 updates, you've got Asus Army Crate updates and BIOS updates, there's more room for things to go wrong there on the ROG Ally than there is on the likes of the Steam Deck OLED, because the OLED is locked down with Linux and it's a controlled environment by Valve that they created on the software. I put the device to sleep, but Power World is still playing, as you can hear from the audio. So this is one of the big downsides of ROG Ally. All in all, as I said, no major gripes with it, and those are the only things I had. I've actually got no problem that the device runs Windows 11. So moving on to the most obvious one, my gaming experience on the ROG Ally, and to summarize it, it's been fantastic. Being able to play PC games, Xbox games with the graphics that you can in high refresh rates on this device has been simply been fantastic. I've made my way through the likes of Resident Evil 2, The Finals, Power World and FIFA 23, and everything looks fantastic on the ROG Ally's 120Hz 1080p display. Some games do require more power than others, but as soon as you plug in the ROG Ally, you get access to an extra 5 watts. So the highest you can go unplugged is 25 watts on the TPD. But as soon as it's plugged in, you get 30 watts, and that tends to just give you enough power on the AAA games if you want to go for slightly more FPS. If you're playing something like Call of Duty where every FPS matters to you, then I'd probably just play plugged in because you get the highest performance possible. The obvious side effect of that, if you don't plug in, is battery life. And for me, this is the single biggest downside of the ROG Ally, and the one that I find so frustrating, and it's such a shame for a device like this, which is fantastic. The Ally has 40-hour battery, so it's smaller than the Lenovo Legion Go and the Steam Deck OLED. And unfortunately it shows, because in most games, especially heavy ones, I've got an hour at most. And when you get some spare time, and maybe it does go over an hour, you have to plug in. And for me, that kind of takes away the shine of the device. Having a handheld portable device that you have to keep plugged in kind of takes away the appeal of having a portable handheld device. And that's where the OLED shines, because the battery on the OLED deck, to be honest, is fantastic. On the opposite side though, I can report that in a positive light, charging on the Ally is really fast. So you've got 65 watt fast charging, so you can top up about 50% in about half an hour, and then a full charge takes just over an hour. So it doesn't take long at all to top back up and get gaming again, but you will have to do that several times a day if you do have a few sessions that you find yourself gaming on. But if I had to choose between having the best performance and rubbish battery life, or pretty good performance and amazing battery life, I'd probably take the better battery life any day of the week, to be honest. As someone who needs access to the device at any time during the day, I want to know that I'm picking up a device that has some charge and can last me during that gaming session. One side of the Ally I've been really enjoying is emulation. So revisiting all the titles that I played growing up, PlayStation 1 or 2, and then some 3DS emulation as well. So it's all been really nostalgic and really cool. I've been using Emudec, so Emudec allows you to load ROMs onto it and play the game straight on the system. So I've been using Emulation Station to browse the games within Emudec. As I said, it's been really nostalgic, so playing games like Super Mario Bros. 2, which I've almost completed, Crash Bandicoot, Spyro the Dragon and Tekken. Honestly, it's been amazing, and it's really nice to revisit several consoles on one device, and it just shows you how versatile these handheld PCs are. I installed all of my ROMs onto the internal SSD on the device. The reason I did that is because the SD card, there's been loads of reports of people's SD cards failing. The fans are just here, as you can see, and the SD card reader is right next to it. And it's resulted in people's SD cards basically being fried by the fan that's there, because the Ally gets pretty hot when you push the performance. So I didn't want to risk it. Didn't think it was worth it, and I think Asus should really officially address it, because I don't think they have, as far as I know. They've just been fixing people's if they've sent them in. I think this is a massive area they need to fix for the ROG Ally 2, which I think they announced is coming out later this year. But it was a terrible insight on the design, just being honest. And it looks like the Emerside Claw probably is going to have the same issue. So at the beginning of the review, I did ask the question, is this device going to be worth purchasing now we're in 2024? And is it worth it considering the competition that it has now from the Lenovo Legion Go and the Steam Deck OLED? And to be honest, my answer is, yeah, this thing is awesome. Being able to play AAA games on a device that fits in my hand is pretty amazing. The Ally having a great screen with really good colors, VRR, and 120Hz panel is really nice. Having Windows means you can access all your game stores. So if you've got existing games, as I said, in other libraries, then Steam, then you can use all of them and access them straight on the device. And the Z1 Extreme chip that's used inside here can give you really good performance on most games and without too much tweaking, really. And the ones that you do have to tweak, you have the power there to make sure you could do most gaming at the frames per second that you want to do with that. And I said the only one big caveat for this device is battery life. And for me, that's obviously the one area that really lets it down, because it is pretty shocking. So if you're the sort of person who needs to pick up a device and play it at any time and you need it to be charged and last, this one probably isn't for you, and I'd go for the Steam Deck OLED, just being honest. But if you're not bothered about battery life and you're near a plug and you're not traveling, then yeah, the ROG Ally is a pretty cool handheld, and I recommend it for you if you are that type of person. As I said, I do have a Steam Deck OLED and I have been using that side by side with the ROG Ally. My review for that one is coming up shortly, as well as loads of accessories for that device. So make sure you hit subscribe so you don't miss out. But as for the ROG Ally, that was my experience of using it after the last few weeks. As someone who's pretty new to the world of handheld gaming PCs and PC gaming in general, I've never owned a PC for gaming. So being from a console background, this was a pretty eye-opening experience. And the thing that surprised me the most is how cheap games are on Steam. It kind of surprised me a lot. So those are my thoughts on the Ally. I'd love to hear what you guys think of it in the comments down below. And while you're there, recommend some games to me. What games are you playing recently? Obviously, being new to Steam and being new to PC, there's loads that I haven't tried. So leave your recommendations for what games I need to try out in the comments down below. And let me know, out of the Ally and the Steam Deck OLED, which one you're choosing? So you're basically talking performance versus battery life. Let me know, leave a comment, we'll have a discussion. If you found this review helpful, hit subscribe, it's got loads of more handheld PC gaming content coming up. But as for today, that is my review of the ROG Ally, and thank you for watching. I'm Luke from Luke Tech Reviews. See you next time.